Let us kneel. O God, who by the passion of Christ, your Son and our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin, by every succeeding generation, grant that just as, being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of man of earth, Adam, so by the sanctification of grace, we may bear the image of the man of heaven, Jesus. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated, my friends.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not yet heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. spirit. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Father, into
a reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Necessary for you to sit to have a greater spiritual experience through this long reading of the Passion. Please don't be embarrassed to do so. Thank you.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him. He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said, Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you're looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter, "He said,
I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I've spoken publicly to the world. I've always taught in a synagogue or a temple area where all the Jews gather. In secret, I've said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I've spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I've spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him, At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him, in order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say I'm a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again. Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
behold, the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, Pilate said to them,
take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered, now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
you'd have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
behold, your king.
They cried out. Pilate said to them,
shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
we have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
what I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, in order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, they divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother, and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother, and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
it is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
We kneel. We stand.
Now, since it was Preparation Day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled: not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. It says in the book, a brief homily follows. You're an optimist if you think the priest is going to give a brief homily. But you're supposed to laugh. That was your big joke for the day. So what do you think we'll remember in 5 years? Those of us who are lucky enough to be alive 5 years from now, what will we remember about this past year? There may be a lot of answers to that question. A year without an Easter, basically. Imagine that. But you know what I think they'll remember? I hope I'm alive 5 years from now. It'll be one simple sentence. I can't breathe. You know, I've been in the hospital rooms. I was almost in one yesterday with the patient on a ventilator. Remember about a year ago today, we didn't have enough ventilators. And all sorts of things were going on trying to get ventilators. Why? Because the person can't breathe. And maybe that could have been some of you. No one that I know of here. But you got to be able to breathe or you're dead. That was just about a year ago right now. And then we had the George Floyd incident yelling, I can't breathe. That trial is going on as we speak today. Amazing. I say that because why did Jesus die? Because he couldn't breathe. Couldn't breathe. If you were the medical examiner, if they had one, 2,000 years ago, and you went to do an autopsy on the body of Jesus, the answer would be he died of suffocation, asphyxiation. He couldn't breathe. Imagine what it would be like to have your hands nailed to the piece of wood, your back open with the scourging, trying to lift your back, rubbing against the wood. Imagine what that would be like. Trying to lift your body up to be able to fill your lungs with breath. Imagine what that would be like. For hours. The only word for that would be agony. I don't have a stronger word. Excruciating agony. Until eventually the person would say, I give up the ghost and would just die. They break the leg so the person couldn't even lift his... Just an awful way to die. I can't breathe. So that would be the medical finding. He died of asphyxiation or suffocation. Spiritual answer of why Jesus, but that's how he died. The why he died, the spiritual answer is entirely different. And the answer is love. It's the only answer. See, Adam and Eve were in the garden.
Notice how the story ends in the garden. None of that's a mistake. They're in the garden, and they're only given one thing to do, and that's just don't eat from that one tree. That's all they had to do. All they had to do. One thing. And then we hear the most famous line of the Old Testament. It's on page 2. Who told you you were naked? Who else is there? Who told you you were naked? Their sin wasn't disobedience as much as they loved themselves more than God, which caused the disobedience. They ate off the tree because their love for each other was stronger than their love for God. And then death has to enter the world. God never intended anyone ever to suffer. They were in paradise, for heaven's sake. But now death will enter the world, and that's not the worst part of it. I mean, eventually the body would have quit. You only live so long. But now when men died, there was not only death, but dread, because there was no hope of heaven. The door was shut and locked. Basically, they threw away the key. Hopeless life happened in the garden. Hopeless. Man couldn't go to heaven because Adam and Eve's love was so selfish. And then along comes Jesus, whose love is so perfect that in perfect obedience to his Father and in perfect love for us, where once a man ate from the tree and was told, who told you you were naked? Hangs from a tree, the Son of God, naked. It tells us that they threw dice for his clothes to save us from that dread and give us hope of eternal life. And death, which ruled from the minute God said, who told you you were naked? Until Jesus hangs naked. From that one moment to the next, Satan was in charge. Yes, Jesus is suffering. But Satan is suffocating. Because he no longer has any power. Now we have hope of eternal life. Because someone's love was so perfect. So perfect. There is no more perfect love than the cross we're about to carry down. Can't be believed how much God loved us to send Jesus to die for us, and Jesus did it. So we carried a cross down the aisle in 5 minutes. The purpose of life is to learn how to love. The meaning in your life comes from being able to give your love away. Young people have to learn, have to be able to do both of those things. It's hard to do either one of them. But only when you give love away is it true. You see? See how that works? So as you come forward to bow at the cross, just start right here, come up, bow at the cross, it'll be right here. Don't touch it, don't kiss it, just it'll be far enough away you can't touch it. Head back to your seats. You have to come through the middle aisle. And we have two crosses here made with nails. Am I getting creative or what, huh? And we just ask you to take a nail. They're about 2.5-inch nails. Lent was about your sins that caused the nail to be used for destruction, crucifixion. Hope you had a good Lent. That was up to you. I can't make your Lent for you. Or a nail can be used for construction. If you're going to build a house, you need nails. And that's for the future. So take the nail home. Just take it home. Put it. Don't use it for building. Just use it for a little spiritual keepsake. My sins caused Jesus to die. But my hope of being with him in heaven causes me to rebuild my life with hope. If you do that, you will have a great Good Friday. Let us stand, my friends. You know, it's funny, we have a unique prayer today. Rarely you can say that, but the last
an additional petition, and these are long petitions, if you want to just sit for them, that's okay, is for the COVID virus. Hopefully, next year, that prayer will not be part of our Good Friday celebration. Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty. Almighty and ever-living God, who in Christ revealed the glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout the whole world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishop, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray also for our Bishop Joseph, for all bishops, priests, deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's also pray for our catechumens, those preparing for baptism, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the water of rebirth and baptism, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord. Let's pray also for our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord. Let us pray for the Jewish people, to those to whom God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption, through Christ our Lord. Let us pray for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter the way of salvation.
Please kneel. Stand.
Almighty and ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in this world. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pray for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Please kneel. Please rise.
Almighty and ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God, Father of the whole human race. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Let's pray for those who serve us in public office, that our Lord and God may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Please kneel. Please rise.
Almighty and ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart, the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern us with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, freedom of religion, may through your gift be made secure. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's pray, my friends, to God the Almighty Father, that he may cleanse the world of all error, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Please kneel. Please rise.
Almighty and ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand. We ask this through Christ our Lord. And finally, we pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world today, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith.
Please kneel. Please rise.
Almighty and merciful God, source of all life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world, brought low by this disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us. And in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for the sick, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated, my friends. At this time, my friends, Deacon, myself, our servant, Father God, will head to the back of the church for the exposition of the cross. As I sing, Behold the Wood of the Cross, please do not sing with us. Just pray. Pray the response with us, and then kneel just for a second as we process up with the cross. Thank you.
Please rise. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. Please kneel. Please rise. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. Let us kneel. Please rise. This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. Please come forward as you would for a communion vow. Return to your places, taking a nail as you do so. Thank you. Please rise. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from ever evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever. Please kneel.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Mighty and ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people this Good Friday. We who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of resurrection, may pardon come, comfort be given, faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. For our conclusion, just kneel, please.